Y'all are caught up. Okay, so he broke both bones, the tibia and the fibula, and he's had surgery, and so there's some screws and plates and things in there fixing that now. But when we got to Taos, to the ER, and I saw just how bad it really was, she said, "Man, you got a really tough young man here." And, well, let me back up. When the ski patrol, the lady got him in to the little hut they have there to take care of him. Shane was not with us. He wasn't with us when it happened. He was drinking coffee in the coffee shop. And so took a little while to find him and get him. But when so we were already in the hut when he came in there. And Seth had been in a lot of pain for a couple hours, was really cold from being left in the snow. It snowed 11 inches that day. So he was on the mountain being snowed on. And when you're laying in snow with a trauma, you get very cold. So by the time they got him down, he was just freezing, you know, inside. We couldn't get him warm enough, putting stuff on him, and he was just shaking, you know, and everything. And when we got all done, though, because I had to pull his ski boot off, and if you've ever worn ski boots without a broken bone, it can be quite traumatic to get your foot out of a ski boot.
Yes,
I mean, you just wear yourself out. You get upset. You want to cuss at your husband trying to pull it off. You're like, somebody get this boot off my foot. I'm tired and I can't get it off. Well, I had to pull his boot off while the lady held his leg, trying to cause him as little pain as possible. Of course, caused him some pain, but he didn't do more than moan. And when we left, she said, "Man, you did really good to Seth." And I had a 13-year-old young man in here the other day that didn't even break his leg, but was hurt. And she said the parents had to apologize for his mouth, because his language was so bad. And I thought, isn't that sad? Because we're supposed to, and obviously this boy wasn't being a witness, probably wasn't even born again, but we're supposed to be witnesses of the Holy Spirit on our life. That can, you know, like, evidence itself in the fruit of the Spirit, which is what? Self-control?
Yeah.
I mean, I know he had to be in terrible pain. We didn't even know it was broke at that point. They thought it might be, but we hadn't had an x-ray yet. We really didn't know what situation he was in or what, but we realized as time went on how bad it was. When we got to the ER, we were in there for, I don't know, 7 or 8 hours, I guess. And you know how it is. They've got, you know, those little curtains, cubicles, and people are in other ones, and you know, whatever's going on. So we were in one of those moments where we wondered if they remembered we were at the hospital. And so we'd been sitting there for I don't know how long, just waiting on somebody to come tell us when we could leave or something. And a guy came in to the ER. I never did see him. Shane went out there, but he was absolutely messed up. And he was yelling, "F this and F that." I mean, loud, loud, loud. Shane stuck his head out, because he was going to go see if he could help. And he came back in a minute. He said they got two policemen getting him. He was just going off. I mean, you could not listen. Seth had his hands over his ears. And I guess the nurses had trying to calm him down and saying, "Man, we got kids in here," because he said, "I'm sorry, kids, for my mouth," and then he went again, you know. I mean, I'm telling you, he didn't know any other words. I don't even know what was wrong with him, except probably drugs, but, and it just, the darkness that I felt when I heard him, I thought, how are these people working this all the time? Don't you know it's regular? I mean, I do. I know from Shane's jobs what they have to deal with. It's not uncommon at all, and I'm fortunate I'm not in any of that, and I think, how do they do it?
Yeah, really.
I mean, do your girls have to deal with some of that, or they're in a position not to?
No, they don't deal with that.
Oh, that's wonderful. Praise the Lord for that. Because that's really rough. And I think, I hope those people saw the presence of God on our family. Mm-hmm. That we were witnesses without being saying anything, you know? That we were so calm, that he had such self-control, that... And what it isn't our own ability, it's the peace and the presence of the Holy Spirit on
Amen.
You. You know what I'm talking about? In a hard situation where you could easily be very upset, he could easily be out of control. We could have been, I mean, it wasn't like we weren't stressed, but you know, but we weren't out of control of ourselves by any mean, and just having to deal with what you have to deal with. And so here, you know, it says that we shall be witnesses when the Holy Spirit has come on us. We shall be witnesses to the ends of the earth. We're supposed to be, the Bible says, living epistles to be read by people. Moses said, I got to think about this morning, I think it's in Exodus 33. He talked about He said, Lord, if your presence doesn't go with us, how will they know that we belong to you without your presence? And we were watching Mark Barclay, and he was going through 9 or 8 things that this week he did a Holy Spirit conference, and he went through 8 things that will stop the anointing in your life, and I wish I had time for that, but the one thing I really got to thinking about as he was talking about those, and he was talking along these lines, is can you imagine your life trying to deal with this dark world, the evil, last days generation that we live in, without the presence of God? How would we do it? I mean, I think we're so used to it. That was like when the guy comes in the ER and he's going off on everybody. I'm more protected from things like that generally. I mean, we don't watch stuff like that. We don't. I'm not in a job or in a situation where I have to deal with those kind of people, you know? And so I'm not in those kind of environments very often. So it probably got on me worse than it would somebody who was more used to it. But we're so used to the anointing and the light and the truth and the presence of God. Isn't it good?
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And I think, how are people even surviving in this dark world? I do not know. Well, not very well.
That's right.
Not very well. And so here's what Moses said. He said, how then will it be known that your people and I have found grace in your sight, except that you go with us? In the Amplified, it says, is it not in your going with us that we are distinguished? It's because of his Holy Spirit coming on us and filling us. And that anointing that comes on us, that's how people are going to know. That's how we're going to be witnesses in this dark world. I mean, I'm not saying don't preach to people. I'm saying we shouldn't really have to a lot of the time. Or I really believe that it's so dark out there that if you are just walking with God and the blessing and the peace of God is in your life, that people are going to come to us in these last days and say, what are you doing? God must be with you. Something is different. How can you live in this crazy country, this crazy world, this crazy society, this culture, all this darkness, and have such a peaceful life? How can you have such goodness in your life? How can you have so much joy? How can you have such good relationships? All these things ought to be evidence of our walking with God.
Amen.
Not that things don't ever happen to you, but how do you get through those things? See? God's presence and anointing. This is interesting, and I hadn't thought about it until I heard Mark Barclay say it. But in Luke chapter 10, where the disciples came back and they were rejoicing that the demons were subject in their name, said, oh man, we can command these demons and they do what we tell them. And he says, hey, you don't need to rejoice that they're subject to you. What you need to rejoice in is that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Y'all know what I'm talking about?
Mm-hmm.
And he said this, and boy, it really, really made an impact on me. He said, we need to not be rejoicing over what we can do, but who we are. Mm-hmm. It's not what we've been empowered to do or what God does through us or what he's called us to do that we're supposed to be rejoicing in. We need to be rejoicing that we're born again, children of God, with the presence of God going with us, with the power of God, yes, but with truth, with light. Don't realize how much light you have? How much truth has been shown to you? Get out there, go to the hospital and sit in the ER for about a day. You'll find out how much darkness everybody's in. Go anywhere. Go to Walmart. Just turn on your TV. Listen to the news. People are in such confusion and in such darkness. We ought to be in such a attitude of gratitude every day just for the light we've been shown.
Amen.
Amen.
Just rejoicing that our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life.
Amen.
We could be in the darkness and the confusion. We could be deceived. We could be all these things that we're seeing going on that could be us. And yet we can sit and we can say, thank you, Lord. Thank you for every bit of light that you've shown to me. Do I know it all? No. But thank you for the light that I have. Thank you. I'm not groping in the darkness.
Mm-hmm.
Confused. Don't know what sex I am. Don't know up from down and right from wrong. Goodness. Thank you, Lord, for that anointing, that presence. It's what's going to cause us to be able to be victorious and live in this world till the Lord returns or we go by the way of the grave, whatever happens. It's what's going to cause people to see that we're witnesses of the power of God, the truth of the Word of God. That's that anointing, we've got to have it. You know, in Isaiah, where it talks about darkness covering the earth, gross darkness covering the people, and it says, you know, that the glory of the Lord will be, what? Seen upon you? Now the first thing of that is talking about Israel. That's a prophecy concerning Israel. But we, and the Gentiles coming to them. But I think you can have a second application and revelation of that and apply it to us as born again people. That the glory of the Lord will be seen upon us, not heard. Not that we have to tell them the glory is on us, but that they'll see it on us. That's what this is talking about in Acts. That this Holy Spirit's going to come on you and you're going to be a witness. Not that you're going to have to tell everybody you're a witness. They're going to see it. Y'all understand the difference? Now, everybody understand it's okay if you tell somebody, right? I'm not, and I'm all saying you can't tell somebody. I'm saying even better than that is they see it. And then you can tell them because they're going to ask questions because they're going to need to know what it is you're doing and what's different. And so, you know, I'm just so thankful for God's faithfulness in our life, but I'm so thankful that He's given us light.
Amen.
And I don't have to live in that confusion. I mean, when I heard that guy, I thought, how sad. I mean, what kind of, I mean, it's horrible. This is all he knows and how he lives, and he's this confused and this, I mean, it was so demonic and so dark and so everything, but that's just not what you want to be around, I realize, but I just think, thank you, Lord, my name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And thank you that we can be witnesses because of the Holy Spirit on us. Amen?
Amen.
And he's on you. And you're being a witness, and your family, and your life, and your job, whatever you're doing, you need to release faith in that and realize, Lord, I'm being a witness. You said, because your presence is on me. They're going to know. They're going to be drawn to that. They're going to see. Not all of them, but some of them. There are those that want rescue. There are those that are looking for a way out. They're looking for an answer. And so we want them to see that on us. Amen?
Amen.
All right. So y'all stand up.